Right, so let's try that introduction about Fusion. So Fusion is basically a rendering engine. And that basically means that we want to output some content basically. And the question is, what is the difference between Fusion and what is Fluid, right? So we have Fluid, which is a template engine. And Fusion is a rendering engine. And I always think of Fusion as something like, a flight controller or something. So that means we have a very complex problem, the problem of rendering a whole website, a whole page, and we try to cut it into smaller pieces to render individual segments, render an individual menu and an individual content block, and basically tear apart the big problem until it becomes small, and then we render the individual part, and then we piece together the pieces so that the big thing or the big result ends up in the end. So that's like my main idea. So basically going to a normal website like the demo site, right? So you have basically for instance, on this page, we have a complex problem rendering this whole website, and we tear it apart to render a menu, to render an individual menu item at the end, or to render the content area, rendering the three column, rendering this left part of the three column, until we only render a single headline or a single content element. And the nice thing is that rendering an individual content element is really, really easy and simple. But the complexity appears because we have to put apart or put together the pieces basically, and that is what Fusion does. It controls. It's basically something like a rendering controller. It controls what to render where and these kind of things. Right. If you have questions, just interrupt me. Right. So. And then there's one really important distinction, which is the so that's like chapter one. So chapter two basically is a node type has nothing to do with Fusion. So in Neos we have the content repository, and the content is structured as a big tree of nodes, as you know. Each node has a certain type. Okay, so basically the idea is if you want to change the tree structure in itself, you always have to go to the node types, so to configure the properties of the nodes, to configure the child nodes, the types of child nodes, constraints, that's all node types YAML. And if you want to change the rendering, then it's Fusion or Fluid, depending on where you have to go. So, but that's just extremely important to keep in mind. So first it's always the structural modeling on the tree side, and then you think about, okay, how can I actually render that? And so that's like chapter two, basically. Flo, you have just already said it. There's some default glue code, basically. Which means that you can only write, so basically the way is always you have YAML, you have node types on the one side, then you have some Fusion glue code, and then you have a Fluid template which renders an individual part. So that's just a general idea, but the middle part, so the Fusion glue code, is auto-generated from node types, because otherwise it would be really a lot of boilerplate. You would have to write for common cases, so that's why we automatically generate the boilerplate code from the node types. I will check that in a bit, how that looks like. But so that's why you can actually... so that's basically enough for simple cases. But for our cases, it's basically never enough, so you always will have to change it at some point in time. So we'll check that in the end, what this auto-generated auto-generated stuff is. So now let's get to the core of Fusion. Now that's actually that. So far it was all just like introductional stuff. Now we are getting to the heart of Fusion itself. For me, actually, I think what do you need to know about it? So Fusion has is basically a big tree, a big rendering tree, which is built up. So that's how this syntax with the dots appears. So you have something like page.foo.bob or page equals page, page.body equals, primary equals primary content, and so on and so on. And you can always, you can always write it in a different format. So you could write something like, path equals. You could write something like this, or you write it differently. You can just use brackets, but I mean that's just so basically like this. So these two things are the same, right? So you can either have the full paths always, or you can just nest it. So that's just a little syntax. So important, Fusion is a big rendering tree. And this tree has, again, nothing to do with the node tree at all. It's completely different from the node tree. That's just extremely important to keep in mind, so just to not confuse these two parts. And basically, a Fusion object is like a pure function. And that means it has multiple input values and a single output value. And often this output value is HTML. Sometimes it is an object or anything, basically. So it can be any arbitary PHP thing.
And it would be an object if you want to fill like a fluid template with it and you get the properties as an
No. So often output is HTML, sometimes it's an object, as already said. And just for reading, if I would like to translate, if I take this part, for instance, and would like to translate it to a normal function, you could write something like, you say page.body.primary equals, we have a primary content function, and it takes as input, takes the node path main. So that could be if I invent some kind of syntax, right? So it's really a function which depends on everything which is inside here as output.
But this would also take the fluid template and then output HTML.
Yes, if it has a primary content, does not have a fluid template directly, but you could have, you have an element called template, mm-hmm. and this outputs, this renders fluid and outputs HTML. Oh. Yes, exactly. So, so that means, so if a Fusion object is a pure function with many input values and a single output value, and this is basically how you see how the big, so this is, we always start rendering at page equals page, normally, so that's basically how the why there's just one output of the page, right? Because what we essentially describe as fluid is just a really, really big nested function, and the output of the full function is the full template, basically, right? And we decompose it into very small parts, into very small functions, up to the smallest detail. Right. And now let's get to there's one thing we are still missing, and that's until now we've just described static information, right? We didn't this is a static node path, whatever that means. So there's just static values. We didn't take any dynamic value from anywhere yet. It's it's all static functions with no interaction yet. So that's why we need to introduce the Fusion context, which contains basically variables we want to render. It contains the data we want to render. So that means up to this part we have nothing, we have not done anything with nodes or anything yet, right? But that's what the context is now about. So if I have something like pay, I don't know, let's think about an example, foo equals, so this case it's just a simple value, right? And if I want to do that, make that interactive, you need to access the context, and the context can be accessed through eel. So you could do something like that. If the context contains a variable called my variable, then this is the way you get it through to the to Fusion, basically, right? So this is how you get things from the basically the things you want to render are all stored in the context, in the Fusion context, and the way you access them is then through eel. And by convention in NEOS there is a variable called node, which contains the currently rendered node. So, and the important part is that's basically the only part of interaction between the structure tree, so the node tree on the one side and the rendering on the other side. It's only by reading things from the context and by updating the context. And we didn't get along on how to update the context yet. That's what we will do in a second. So that was what we've done, is basically reading the context. And we can also post-process the context. So that's by using eel helpers. That means if my variable, for instance, we can do something, I don't know, string dot trim or something like that. So we have some helper functions available which allow us to post-process the value in any way we want. And now the question is, how do things get into the context, right? So how do we get the variables in there and how do we update them? And for getting variables into the context, that can happen in basically three ways. First way is from outside, basically from the controller, using this view assign. So that's basically how you fill the context initially, right? This is inside the controller, yeah? And that's basically what is done in NEOS. This line is somewhere in the NEOS core, which says, please render my current document node.
So if I'm using something from inside the NEOS package in my Fusion script, the best way to know what the context is composed of is to look into the controller.
Yes.
To find out the...
Yeah.
Because for me that's the most important thing. How do I know which?
I can show you. So in the front end, so it's basically front end node controller is the one which is the it's the show action exactly. And actually it's done, I'm not sure where it's done. Maybe I misspelled things now. I thought it was here. Check. Here we have. So it's essentially it's just very little which is outside. It's basically just the three of these. This is the important part. So it's the node, the one which you're currently rendering, and the document node. And the document node in the beginning is really just the current node we are rendering. So they are the same, mm-hmm. right? And the idea is that the document node is always the entry point of the document you're currently rendering, and the node will change over time as we do the rendering. So the context can change over time as we do a rendering of a page. Okay. Right? Because if we render, so if we start rendering, so we are up here, then the node is the whole page. If we are at some point down here, then the node will be just the single headline element we are rendering. So it will,
we are going down the tree. The context like shrinks, but
well, we also update node. It exactly. We also update the context from time to time, and we'll get to bit how this works exactly.
An example for the menu implementation, I could also look into controller and see, okay, I have maximum levels. These would be also properties that are assigned to the context.
No, they are properties of the. So, what you have is if you do a menu, you have something like, I don't know, menu equal. Oh no, my menu equals menu. Mm-hmm. And then you have something like maximum levels equals 10, right? as an example. That's how you write it. So that is just a configuration of the menu function. So that has nothing to do with context. What you could, of course, do is something like this. You could say, node. It's a stupid example, but I could do something like node.properties.maximum levels. So I could take some information, take some information from the node and calculate that dynamically. But yeah. So as I said, the first thing is from outside the controller using this view assign. Second is using add context. That looks the following. So let's say we have let's think of an example. Let's say we have in Fusion that is. And example would be the following. We have my container. Let's say we created my container. That's a Neos Fusion. That's a Neos this way Neos Fusion template. So that's so template is the one which has a fluid template inside, right? Mm-hmm. So it has some template path where the fluid template is, and then we pass on some variables to the template. So we say something like and the template could be something like the following. It could contain my headline, and then we have something like my content, like this, right? This could be the template implementation. And this my headline here references a property of the Fusion template. So that means we can say something like my headline equals my static text, and say my content equals my other text, right? I mean, this is basically pulling the Fusion part and the template part together. So again, the logic is basically we want to render the whole thing, the whole template. So the template implementation itself starts rendering the template, and always when it occurs, when in Fluid such a placeholder is appearing, then it just renders the corresponding part of itself. So that means this way we can again make that dynamic, right? We can make something like node properties dot something. Oops. But what we can also do is, for instance, for the content, we could say something like, let's say we want the content, we want to use we want to put in a normal, a text element. So what we would like to do is Neos node types text. So we would like to say, so this basically says, use the Neos node types text Fusion object to render my content, right? And because this is again also just a function returning a single value, which is the value of the currently rendered of a text element, this will just work. And what we now can do is do something like this, which is overriding the context, which is saying my content dot add context node equals, I'll just write it down in an explainer view, node children my text. So let's put that as an example. Okay. So what this means is so outside the basically up here the node is still the one it is before, right? The node which was set from the outside. And what we do, what this means is inside rendering my content, we reassign the node variable. So that means in that part, the node variable means something else. And that means, for instance, what we could do is we take the node we have so far, which is the node of our current element, and we go to one child node, which is the my text child node, and we fetch that one. Right. So basically, what we do now is we have. So the way I visualize it always is that you have a big tree of nodes in the node, and then you have a pointer to one of the nodes which you call node. Right. This is the node variable which we have in Fusion. And what you can do is now while you render is you can change the pointer. You can say now I want to point on some other node element basically. And that's exactly what we do here. We say for rendering my content, we take some other node as context.
Where does this child come from?
Well, I mean, we have to ensure that node at this point is a node which has a my text child, so that would have to be configured in node types YAML accordingly.
Okay, so that would be an child node.
An auto-created child node, for instance, exactly. Okay. Yeah.
With this ID.
Yes, okay. Yeah, exactly, with this name.
And
yes.
For example, if I would say I have a current use case, I have a home page, mm-hmm. and at the top of the starting page, I would like to curate the main menu, like mm-hmm. putting things together, so there will not be an auto-generated menu.
Mm-hmm.
And then I want to render this part on every page that is not the home page, invisibly on the page. That if I click the menu, this node
is there. Yeah.
That would be the same. I would.
Yeah, you would somehow exactly. You could, for instance,
the collection of the home of the start page.
Yeah, which is site, right? So site is the root. Then you could do something.
Instance of probably.
Yeah, exactly. You filter it down, and this is what you use
then,
further on.
And then choose the content collection.
Yes, choose the right one. Exactly. Yeah. That's what you could do. So basically, that's how you can override the context. And
how would I, if my content now is a NEOS node type text, whatever?
Yeah.
How can I pre-fill it with text? Oh, I choose a different.
Well, if you want to pre-fill it, like then this is like the default value is the thing you would do in the node types YAML, right? So if you have to do some pre-filling, then so the important part is you always have to know. So Fusion gets a lot easier. You always need to know what is in the context currently. So that means you at least need to know. Okay, there's a variable node in there, and for instance, this has a type. I don't know what. What could we have? My container. Let's say we have it, right? If this has the type my container, this is what we need to know at this point in time. And then we know, okay, basically we have to, the my container needs to have a child property my text. So you always have to keep these two pieces in sync, basically, and know. And this is done through conventions, basically. So we come to that in a bit. So, right, if you know the node has a certain type, then you know it has children of certain thing, and then you can access them. If node was not of my container outside here, but of, I don't know, of something completely different, of a page, for instance, a page probably doesn't have a child my text. So this would just return an empty thing, so not a null object. Right, and the third thing is...
the get will explain later?
Yeah, that's just a detail. We'll just skip it for now. That's just really detailed. And the third thing, how you can actually change variables in the context is that a Fusion object itself can change the context below it. So that means, we'll come to that in a bit, how this is used, but basically that means that we could implement this object in a certain way so that for everything inside it, some other properties appear in the context automatically.
You could override the node property?
For instance, you could do that. You could override the node property or you could do other things. I mean, I'll show you an example how this is in detail. So basically that means, what did we do now? We said there is a Fusion context, right? And we say, okay, how can we actually modify it, right, to these three variants? Basically, this is the third one is the one which the framework uses internally, which you yourself won't use that often. And actually, this is the one you will use. So this is the one you will use in practice as well. And important is the context is basically... So there are like two APIs a Fusion object has, right? The one API is which properties does it have inside, which you can change. This is the one thing. And the second API is what does it expect to be on the context. So for instance, the text, right? The node types text, for instance, expects a variable called node, which is in the context. And it expects it to be of type text, of type NEOS node types text, because this is what it will render. And if you break that contract, then it will render something else, but not what it is intended. So that's the two things you have to keep in mind.
But the the TypeScript object created is the my content of the type text.
Yes, of the. So there is a.
But then I need to map. Don't I need to map like my content at context.node.text to the keynote children.
No. That's done one level down. So what text internally does? So we can go through that. So Fusion has a concept called prototypes, which is basically just like a class, right? So it's basically just a. And what this does internally is something like text equals Q node property.
Can I specify my question a little bit more detailed? You have neos, control types, text,
yes.
So the child has to be of the same type, has to be of text.
Well, exactly. So my text has to be of type text.
Because inside there is a property,
yeah.
Property text that the object type expects to be inside.
Yeah, exactly. So basically it says. So basically, right? So this text prototype here expects that the node at this point, so the node in the context is instance of the node type text.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be confusing, but you know this thing and this thing are actually two completely different things. So this is the name of the node type, right? And this is the name of the Fusion prototype. And this could be, basically it's a convention that this matches, and I'll show you where this convention is implemented, but this can be two completely different things. So you could say, I call this thing text XYZ, and I also call this text XYZ, right? Because this is the prototype again, and this would work, right? And it doesn't need to match with a node, with the name of the, or with the type of the node. Which one? That's just a comment. Yeah, that's just so of. So that's like the more explicit thing. So so I think that was already a lot to digest, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now we are basically going a little level down because what we are still missing is we are still missing control structures. So that's like the next really big topic. So what we've seen so far is everything which is the language, it's fluid language, so like the basic principles, the basic structural ideas, and so on. What we now get to is basically the language library. So, you know, we didn't talk about if or else or a loop or anything like that, but of course you will need that for rendering content. You need to say, okay, we loop here over all content in here, for instance, right? And the nice thing about Fusion is that the language so the control structures are all implemented as a Fusion object. So that means there's no controls. So there's no for syntax available, but it's just a normal function. There's just a for function available, basically, which is called collection, which we'll see in a bit. So next really big topic is actually. It's control structures in Fusion. And then we'll go to we basically see how Neos internally works, and then I think then you have a really. So first, let's check the template object. So that's just a very basic one. We already covered it, but just to. So that's Neos Fusion, Neos.fusion template. And that's basically that's the bridge to Fluid, right? So that's what you just see very, very often. So that's how Fluid is called, and Fluid can then call back. So that's what we basically did up here, right? That's exactly the same thing as we just sketched out here. That's not a control structure, but it's just an important building block, essentially. Okay, so now let's check how we do a loop. So there's two kinds of control structures. There's loops and there are if conditions. That's like, exactly. So that means, so the loop basically is called a collection. And what this collection does is it works the following. Let's just say Neos Fusion collection. You have to specify what the collection is. So as an example, I just specify an array 1, 2, 3. So that's an array of numbers now with three elements, right? 1, 2, and 3. And then for every, and then you have an item name. That's I'll get to. That's basically the name of the for loop. And then I have an item renderer. It's let's say Neos Fusion template with some template path, and we say, I don't know, index equals I. So, and then...
It could also be an XML.
Yeah. So in template, my index is I. So just to, a lot has happened in this small thing, right? So if I would write that in PHP, it would basically be something like output equals empty string for each collection as item or as E, that would be a better name. And then we say render template with index E. It's not really PHP, but like the pseudo code, right? We collapse that and then we say return output. So that's what I would write in PHP, right? So the collection is like the input we are iterating on. The item name is the thing, is the variable name which the element is made available under. And then you have the item renderer, which is the body of the loop. So which is everything between here and here, right? And this is what this collection uses internally. It will automatically change the context because it will need to make the I variable available for the item renderer, right? Because what this will output is my index is 1, my index is 2, my index is 3. So that's like the output of here is 1, 2, 3. So basically the idea is as said, so basically we have a collection, we modify the item, and this way we have this variable available here, right? So this could also be called ifoo, I don't know, and then this must be also called ifoo just to match together. So that's like the first really, really, really important building block. Michael, so 4 questions, everything okay?
But okay. I'm not quite sure what this item name means, because is it some magical syntax, or?
Well, basically, if you didn't have that, then the question would be, how would you access the current element?
Of course, yeah.
Right. So, you know, I would like to access 1, 2, and 3 here, but what do I write here? So you are missing. It's basically as saying something like this in PHP. You would say for each collection as. What? And you need to give this thing a name.
Yeah, of course. But the name, item name is curious for me, because it's never used again.
Well, actually, no. Actually, this is all a property. So the collection has the collection object has a certain API, and this API says I expect the collection itself, so the array, to iterate over in the name collection. Yeah. And I expect the iteration variable in the name item name. That's just the API.
Okay. No, it's clear for me.
Okay, cool. So that's just, so these three things, how they are called, are just API of the collection itself, right? And
okay. And
you can also check that if you want, if you go to collection.fusion. Oh no, it's actually, I hope at least, maybe you can't, but it should be documented. Actually, it is documented in the, so how these variables on the end, this is documented for the API documentation of all these Fusion objects, what is available there. So that's like the loop, that is like the first really important building block. All is okay?
Yeah,
that's good. So.
You just showed where the documentation is inside the
implementation. Yeah, well, no, not really, but I just showed that these three things are like the API of the collection, right? So how this is called. Okay, that's a loop, okay? So second building block is an if condition. And the if condition is, I'll just also write it down, let's say it's, so important, I always have to assign it a variable, right? So I have to say x equals collection, or you cannot just do it in the empty space, basically, but you need to say something like x equals, it's a case object. And the case object is basically a big switch statement, as you know, like switch case thing. So my condition A equals, again, and then for each part you have a condition. I don't know, that's probably false. It's a stupid condition, obviously, but, and let me just check. I just need to check one thing that I don't program. Just one thing to check. Remember this one is. Okay, yeah. So what you have is you have multiple blocks of these conditions. It checks, basically, it just checks from top to bottom, it checks all the conditions, and if the condition is true, then it does something. Yeah, and it can do a variety of things. It can, if renderer is specified, this one is rendered. So right, so if I have a renderer property, then this is the one which is used. So that means it could be also, yeah, we come to it in a bit, but for now, in this small example, right, the value x would be my value foo, right, because that's the static string here. If I say this is true now, then the renderer would be, the x value would be my value, because this is the first condition which matches. And you are totally right, Flo, you can of course mix that. You can say, okay, this is now, I don't know, Neos primary content or whatever. So you can do all kinds of fusion objects again, which do the actual rendering. Okay, so that's you don't need a break statement because the first condition which is always break, basically. The first condition, the first one which matches is executed, and then it's aborted. Yeah. The default is just the one you specify with condition here, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So at the end of the something that is always true.
Exactly, and that's the default. Exactly. There's, by the way, one thing which is just a small, that's like a detail, you can change the ordering of the conditions using the add position, which is like a meta syntax. You can say something like position add position end, which effectively would move this block down here, and that's just sometimes needed for extensibility reasons, but you won't need that very often. But that's just,
if you overwrite your own thing, you could just write my condition A. You don't change the condition in the renderer, but you just change
the position. Position. But that's dangerous. You need to, of course, need to be aware of what you're actually changing. But you could do that. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and so that's nothing you will often do. What you might do maybe is say something like position, and to enforce the default is at the end or something like that. That might be useful. So, as said, if renderer is specified, then this leaf basically is rendered, right? So this element or this tree part is rendered. Then there's another thing, which is, you can specify if render. So that's what you use used very often, definitely. So then there's a second property which is called render path. If specified, this absolute path is rendered. Don't use the shortcut. I'll just write don't use that part. So that would mean if I don't specify renderer here, but instead I specify render path equals y. Yeah? And what y dot foo. So what this would now do is it would render y foo, I don't know. It would render this element. And you should not, just don't use it. Just directly forget about render path. That's really just an implementation detail which we are used internally, which I can show you.
So you would probably use it to render a template, but therefore you would probably use template and not this.
Yeah, you wouldn't use, you shouldn't use the path, but you should, that's the third part. You would always use a prototype for it. And that's the third part. Mm-hmm. If the type is specified, this fusion object is is rendered. So I'll show that. So that means, let's as an example, so type equals neos node types text. So this basically renders, this triggers rendering of the text prototype, the diffusion prototype called text, okay? So that's basically the same as, just from the behavior, but it's basically the same as saying renderer equals neos node types text. See the difference? So the one is without quotes, so this is just, we instantiate the object directly and we use it. And this is just a string which has to be a fusion type.
The top you would use if you want to like use the curly braces to put in some more properties, and the bottom you would just
not. What? No. The top one is a static one. But you are actually right on the the cool thing. So the first one is static. So you can never change this dynamically at runtime. You know, because it's just it's directly hard coded basically.
Yeah.
And the second one, this is dynamic. So that's why you could do something like you can use an IL expression here, right? And you can do something like node type name. Right, we just take the current node type's name, I think what we do in code is, I'm not sure, but something like that, we do it differently. So we can dynamically choose which type we want to continue rendering. Yeah.
What if I want to render a template and change the template path? Right there in the condition. But does it work? Could I say?
Yeah, you could. Yes.
That's what I meant with the curly braces. Could I write renderer equals neos.notetypes.
You could use template.
Template, and then you have the curly opening curly brace, closing curly brace, and then write template.
Yeah, you can do that.
That's what I meant. Yeah. With
that's fine. Now. That's totally fine. Yeah, you can do that. Yeah. But the important thing is, so that's the only part. So this dynamic invocation is extremely important, because what this allows us is to dynamically decide on how we want to continue rendering, with which type we want to continue rendering, right? Because we can basically say, okay, now at this point we want to continue rendering at a different object type. Okay, so that's what we call dynamic dispatch, and that's extremely important. You will not have used it so often yourself, but that's how the framework internally works. I'll show you in a bit. But did you understand how this dynamic type stuff work? At least this is like filled dynamically from context? Okay.
Well, you have this property, so you can use the Helix, or that is evaluated.
Yeah, exactly. You can use eel here, or you could even use another fusion object to which returns the type. I mean, nobody does it. Usually, you just use it using eel, right? But you can you can dynamically choose how you want to continue rendering.
So that's why you introduce the type property.
Exactly. Yes. So and now we basically can to. So what we can now do is we'll check the default fusion, which is so first we check the default fusion, which is automatically generated by the system. So remember up here we had the idea that so we said there's some default glue code generated, right, from node types to fusion glue code to fusion template, and I'll just show you this fusion glue code in a second. And then we check, and then I'll explain how like the internals of Neos work with the. So now we basically have all ingredients. Now it's really just.
So all node types are evaluated, and if you use like something like text, you run into the type equals something, and then.
Yeah, that's how it works internally. Yeah, I'll show you that part in a second. Exactly. Yeah. So, but just first, I don't know. Let's just check node.
Ask is probably for glue code.
No, I'm not sure. I forgot about it. It's somewhere here. It's in fusion. It is in. Let me just check. I thought so at least. It could be fusion. So the Fusion view is the one which let's let me just check that. It's not so important. I just want to do some debugging. I want to add some debugging output, basically. Fusion service, here we go. It's just the one. Just that you get merged fusion object tree, blah, 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 get fusion. So generate node type definitions, here we go. So, keep it up. Okay, there we go. So I'll open it in the default. So this is all the auto-generated code, okay? And I hope so at least. Let me just check. Node fusion generate node type definitions. Yeah. Yeah, right. And actually, this is. So let's just take these two as examples because they are really, really easy. So the default glue code looks like this. We always, so basically it says for all content, so for everything inheriting content, for all node types inheriting content, we create a same named fusion prototype. Yeah. And it always looks like this. It basically says we have some template. This is the default. So it always inherits from Neos content. So we have these two hierarchies. We have the node hierarchy and the node type hierarchy. We have three three hierarchies. We have the node structure. Yeah. We have the node type hierarchy, which is basically saying this node type has the parent of this or that. And then we have the third one, which is the fusion prototype inheritance, right? So because with this line, which I've just highlighted, we basically say headline extends from content, right? This means extending. So and now what we do is for everything which inherits from the node type content, we create this fusion prototype, which just has a template path by convention, right? So basically building up this part, and then it basically says, and then it only contains this line which says, please map the title property into the fluid template. So if we didn't have that, then in Fluid, we wouldn't have the title property available, but we would need to manually do that all over again and again and again. That's why we auto-generated this.
Because the headline doesn't have a title of its own?
No, because it couldn't render the title, actually. You know, if the template, so let's say headline HTML, that looks something like this, right? Yeah. I don't know, maybe like this. Let's say it's always H2. So this way it works. If we do like,
mind it's a blue code.
Yeah, but still it's important. Like if we just remove this line completely, right? What would happen is that this title would reference a non-existing title property here, and because that doesn't exist, nothing would be rendered.
Just got it mixed up with. I was wondering why is it automatically working, but
That's the point where the auto generation happens. Exactly, yeah. Exactly, right. So that's that one, and actually for and you also see it right for image. It's the same thing. It's image, alternative text, title, link, has captions, all passed through, and then there is some special logic still which ensures that URLs are converted, but that's just a detail again you can just ignore for now. So it's just the main part is really that all the properties are mapped through. That's the important part. And for other elements, I think I'm not sure. All right, and the only thing which changes for document nodes, so non-content nodes, is the basic is it doesn't extend from it will extend from document Neos document instead of Neos fusion template. But we can ignore that. So the important part is just to remember that this automatic mapping here happens.
Because for the one we have a template, and for the other one we don't.
Yeah, we will do a different this part differently. Anyway, yeah, second. Okay, so that's the auto-generated glue code. So basically now the last part I would like to show is the is actually how NEOS works internally. Because now we have seen everything, like all the pieces together, and now I can actually walk you through the NEOS Fusion code itself. So the standard Fusion code. So how do we start? Right. So we have root that just includes two files. That's a little boring. Important is, I will copy it apart and remove some parts. So rendering always starts at root. That's the first thing you need to know. So that's just the convention from the framework internally. And the standard Fusion object is a case object, which you already know, right? And this case has lots of cases. It has shortcut. So it has everything related to backend, basically. That's all kind of things related for backend rendering. So you can basically just all ignore them, except for one, which is this one, right? Which is a default case again. And that's the only point where render path is used. So that's how we get from rendering root to rendering page equals page, right? Because that's how we enter rendering.
Yeah. The whole root thing is system internal?
Yeah, I mean, you can extend it if you want to, on top level, want to change the rendering completely.
Yeah.
But in the root, we also do stuff like the edit preview modes in NEOS backend, mm-hmm. or shortcut handling, or handling different formats or layouts. So you can intercept that or change that if you like to, but basically that's just very, very early. And what we also do here is caching, but that's a different story. So that also is configured in Fusion, but you don't need to think about that. And also how exceptions are handled, like if something goes wrong, that's all handled there. So there are some additional details, but so that's basically like that's like the minimal rendering, actually the minimal critical path, basically, right?
And then you overwrite page for your own.
For your own liking. You instantiate page and then you start overwriting it. That's just a typical behavior, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now let's look at page. So that's prototypes. By the way, if you're in many cases, if I would like to know the prototype of page, you can just go to page.fusion, or in the old version, page.ts2, right? So and it will directly, you will directly jump to the standard implementation. And what is done here? This is inheriting from HTTP message, which is a very internal thing, which is basically just the most basic, like the HTTP envelope. And you see what we start here is really we started. So this is basically an array. So it renders the doc type first, then it renders the HTML tag with all kinds of attributes, only if we are not in live workspace. Then we render a headlock comment. We render the head tag, we render the head, we render style sheet stuff. Then we render the body tag. And then we render the body. So that's all. This is the whole thing. Is basically like, you know, if you do page equals page, this is basically all copied in here, and then you can start extending it. So that means if you do like page.body.template path, right? This is how you usually start, right? What you basically are doing is that you add to this part, to the body part, which is of type NEOS Fusion template. You add a property. So you say it's like template. Equals, right? And that's by coincidence, basically, this is the only property which is missing in here. So that's why it just will work as soon as you set this single property.
Mm-hmm.
And then it, and basically, right, so what happens?
It would be the default HTML thing in the package, right?
What?
The default HTML template in here?
Is the one defined by this file, yeah. And page.body is the body part is the one which is just the body markup, right?
Yeah.
So the inner part of the of what you like. So the body part of the template. The rest of the template is generated by this part,
mm-hmm.
by this thing. Huh? So what does happen here?
And you normally don't have a template part there, but some case statements for the section.
Well, now here you have it usually, because this is the normal body template you're creating. So this is the default HTML template you are having in. So for instance, Yeah, exactly. So that's like, I don't know, Neos demo default.html, and then you might specify something like a body.section name, right, to just render. So for instance, in the Neos demo site, Fusion, let's just check that. Here, if you see that, right, this is this line, you say page.body.template path is Neos demo private templates page default. Mm-hmm. And what you usually do is that you use a section, you specify a section name, but that's just a fluid internal, which basically just pulls out, it just allows us to render, to have a big template and then have these, just the part of this, everything inside this section mm-hmm. being pulled out. So you could also split it into totally different files if you like to, right? So the section is really just what is pulled out of the fluid template and rendered. So that means in default HTML we have something like an F section name body, right? So that's important because I specified it here. If I would drop it, then it would just use the full file as the template. Flow, okay.
No, I'm checking in a different project.
And here you would basically you would do something like I don't know, content.main. So I think that's just again important. So right, if I specify content.main here, then you would need to do body.content.main, and you could say something like my content. So that's just static content. That's pretty boring, right? What you usually do, and that now, this is how you say, this is basically Neos primary content, okay? Mm-hmm. So I'll just need to mark some things, like this is the default. I'll just try to mark the things which are default and then the things we are doing ourselves, just to, you know, so we traced rendering from top to bottom, and now again, Neos primary content kicks in, right? And primary content is something is of type case. So so what this does is now is and I think you're getting some kind of pattern now. So primary content is a case, right? So you specify the node path because that's what you do when you say, you usually say something like node path equals main here. Right, you say basically which part contains the primary content collection of my node tree, and this is the node path which the user specifies. This is exactly this thing. By using this, I didn't show you yet. By using this, you can reference all nodes, all things on the same path. So that means this node path references this thing the user overwrote here. And puts it into the context. The only reason for that is otherwise there would be no way to pass this node path up here, down here to the content collection renderer. Okay, so that's very deep in details, but basically what we do in primary content is we just set up a default collection and we always render using Neos content collection. See that? Right? So we have an indirection. Primary content defers to to content collection. And now it's getting to the real. I'll explain that in a bit. So let's say to do why. I'll explain that in a second. So let's check content collections. Content collection. I'll try to I'll basically remove everything now which is not strictly needed. Okay, so so there's a lot of details here. So there's a lot of details, but essentially it boils down to this, and then we have So content collection is just is a wrapper tag, because we need this for the UI, right? So the UI needs a div around all collections so that it can group it together. That's why content collection is inheriting from tag. And the renderer, so the actual body of the content collection is the content collection renderer. And this one is actually inheriting from, now we are getting there. Yeah, it's a lot of things. Almost. Yes. So basically, I'll just again slim down some parts because it's otherwise it gets more difficult to trace. So let's just check that. I'll help you in a second as again. Oops. So, and this one renders the content case, and now we're almost at it. As I said, it's a lot of indirection, but it has its use, and that's what we'll show, what I'll show you. Okay, so now we have it. So again, we say, okay, primary content, this just defers to the content collection, okay? So what this does, you don't need to bother in detail, it doesn't matter. So important is just primary content defers the stuff to content collection. Content collection sets the node context property. So basically this goes one level down. So it changes the node from the, so let's, I'll just show you on the demo side as an example. Yes. Not the end, yes. Admin password. So just to show you on the structure tree, because so just to ignore the output in the middle that we don't need that. So let's just focus on the structure down here. That's the important part. So that means in the beginning, we are at this page level here, right? Because that's how the rendering all started. So that means when we render the root part here, so that means context node page node, right? And this level is the page node. This is where we start rendering. So that's this features page up here. This is also this, we don't change anything here. So the context node is still the page node. That's, we'll just pass through until we change it. And the first part where it changes actually is in this Neos content collection. Here we basically go one level down from node. So we basically do we go one level down and we say, okay, the node property is now the context collection node, the content collection node. So that means this way we go one level down to the main content collection. So now we are here. Don't figure out, like, there are some reasons why this is written like this. Don't bother with it. There are some error handling code in here to make it more nice for the user and so on and so on. So that's just all not really new. And the content collection renderer, again, right, it's still the same context. So that means this collection, so QNode is, again, QNode is still the content collection node, the one we are rendering. So that's still this thing, right? And now we are just saying, okay, the collection, so the things we want to iterate on, this is just a normal collection, right? The things we want to iterate on is just all the children of the content collection. So that means the three column, the two column, the other two column, these three things, that's the content in here. And we use the content case object for every element. So, right, it's a loop basically, and for every element we render it using the content case object. And now we're almost finished. The content case object is really this thing. And what it does, it just says, oh yeah, in all cases, please render a dynamic fusion prototype, which is the same as the node type's name. Finished. So basically, right, so that means this is like how an individual, how this two column thing gets rendered, or the three column thing gets rendered. And the nice thing is, this is really the only place in the core where this convention is encoded, that for every node type you have a Fusion prototype of the same name. If we change that here, then we would need to change that convention. That's the only place where this convention is actually implemented. So there's no place in the code that this is enforced except here. And that's actually the nice thing about it. Okay, so why is that important? The one thing to keep in mind is, so, you know, especially why do I need to have primary content as case here? Why do I actually need that when it's always rendering content collection, right? So always, so the answer is always when you see a content collection, it's a planned extension point. Always you see a case. So a case object in Fluid is in Fusion is always a planned extension point. So that means that is something the user might want to hook into it. Okay? And the rationale behind that for primary content, for instance, is, oh yeah, well the website is pretty much okay. So let's say we have a plugin. This plugin or we have another package. This package gives me blog posts or news articles, so that are document node types, right? And the blog or the news package would just like to control the markup in the main content area. It doesn't care about the layout outside. It's just interested in replacing the main content area. Okay. So what it would actually do is it would extend this prototype. It would say something like, I'll just move that to the bottom, but just for now that we see it, it would say prototype news primary content, special rendering for news, for instance, right? It would add a new condition here, because this condition wouldn't have a position. It would be before the default condition automatically, and that's why it. We would say condition equals, let's say something like qNode is instance of my package news. And if that's the case, if it's a news object, then we say we take our, we render, for instance, my package news in here. Or we could do something like render equals my package news, also fine.
And that's also why you would combine a flow application with the
to have this extension point, right?
So we use the same for the funding platform. At some point in the near template we say,
well, not yet, but this would be useful, yeah. We should do that. Yeah. So, but we are having projects actually where we use the same principle in flow applications as well.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's an example of changing the full body. So the content area of the website, no? Depending on for a certain document type. So that's most useful for creating reusable node types, so reusable document node types, like, I don't know, products or whatever, right? That this is used actually. So there you could hook into the system. And the cool thing is, by using that, the user doesn't need to configure anything. He just installs the package. This package will automatically extend the single rendering, and it will just work for the user. Right? That was the main idea. And the second thing you might want to hook into is actually this content case in here. That's the second use case you might want to hook into. And right, because what you could do here is saying, okay, I want to render my three columns differently, or I want to use, right? In some cases, I want to change the rendering, then you could do it here. You don't usually need it that often, but you could do that example, basically. So that's basically why we have this long chain, and this long indirection, because it has these predefined parts of extensibility.
Okay.
Yes?
About the opening and closing bracket for extending.
So what you do is this is extension, right?
Yeah.
extension, and then you start to modify it, because that's why you want to extend it, to modify it afterwards. And it doesn't clear the prototype beforehand. So that means so you might need this. If the prototype contains stuff you don't want in there, like because it's auto-generated, right? This is basically clearing the auto-generated prototype. Basically, this line never hurts. I mean, you know, if you just add this line always, then you just might clear things which might not exist, but that is okay.
Well, but you would also not get the properties in the.
You would need to exactly. You would manually need to do something like tibel equals qnode property type.
Okay,
so title, exactly. Yeah.
If the prototype already has a title defined, what to do with it, and I would like to like maybe compose a title out of two fields, I'm not able to just write.
Yeah, you can. This overrides it always. You can do
without
that.
Without this line, okay. But why?
The only reason why you need this line is there are certain elements which, so there's an array object, an array thing, which renders everything which exists. So, for instance, as an example, I didn't show you all Fusion Core types yet.
Yeah.
But for instance, the HTTP message. Okay. Mm-hmm. This thing inherits from array, and array is just a type which renders everything, all children, and concatenates them. So that means if I would add something like foo equals before doc type, if I add this here, right? Mm-hmm. Then I would actually, let's go to the live side, I would actually add something for all my templates. It's page source. I would prototype this. Let's ignore the war dump. Oops, didn't break. It could be that because of caching, actually. Oh, I'm on the wrong side. So that should work. Ah, okay, yeah. So if I add something here like foo add position, yeah, now we have it. So that means like in this case, auto-generated properties of page would do harm because they would be outputted, you know, because this is just rendering everything inside, so also auto-generated stuff. That's why we need to clear it here explicitly. Mm-hmm. But usually you won't need that. I mean, that's really an edge case. You need, so we go for that.
I mean, I was in need of it. Using
yeah, it might happen if you use other extensions. It might be something you might need it for. Exactly. Yeah. And maybe just one thing. What is done really often is that you would like to. So as said, the standard fusion which is being used is usually the one I've just written here. So that's just the right with page equals page, but there's actually, this is like the old style, this is like the first version we were doing, also because this was pretty much like it was done in basically the old typo three times. Mm-hmm. So that's why this is still like this. In today's projects we usually use a different paradigm, which I can just show in a bit. So we use a slightly different configuration, and this is the following. Present here, yes, exactly. So what we usually do is I'll just add it down here, new page rendering. So instead of, so the old one again was just putting things in the page, right? Putting, saying page equals something, and then start quantifying the rendering. In the new version, what you need to do is you need to add this one line. So basically we are just changing the root metro. We make sure we don't render a page anymore, but we render the node type appended with document as type here. So that means if we have a node type my pack or neos node types page is rendered using neos node types page dot document, right? Because it says take node type and then append dot document on it. Hmm. Right? That's basically the same dynamic dispatching we are using here for the individual elements. This is what we overwrote here, and that's just a very common practice actually to do, because this way you can use the prototype inheritance in a lot better way. You could say, okay, you have the page document inheriting from template or inheriting from Neos page, and then start defining. So you would just do it on the prototype level, because you could more easily extend from this one and say, we have, for instance, we have my special page or my package special page, right? If we have a document node type of this type, my package special page, then by this line we would have it just render as the default, and then we could start modifying it. This is what we basically do in all current projects.
What does the dot document do?
Which one?
Document.
Well, it's just a convention. It's basically, with this line, we introduce a convention saying we don't render slash page anymore, but we render a prototype of a certain name.
It might be a home page.
Well, normally you would do something like page, so old style, right? Old style, you would do something like page equals page, and then you say body template path equals something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you would like to, let's say, what is very common is that you need a different rendering, so that you say, okay, we don't have just the pages, but we have products, which we want to render differently.
Mm-hmm.
And what we would need to do in the old style is we say root dot products rendering equals that's how we would do it in the old style. We would say condition equals do not is sense of products, something like that, and then render path products, right? So that's something we could do, and then we could say something like product. So the difficult thing is this is copy, not inheritance.
You have
body my body. So let's say we want to change the body CSS class, okay?
I have a document structure tree, document tree,
mm-hmm.
And there I have, I don't know, type. No type page,
yeah,
or shortcut or whatever,
yeah, or products.
And this is everything up to here.
Yes.
So and then I just attach something.
Yeah, let's imagine. Let's just go
a
one
document
step.
Document or
yeah.
I don't know. And then what? Then
this is rendered. So let's just imagine what you need to do. Often, is you say, okay, the standard page template looks like this, right? And if you render products, you want to, basically, what you would like to do is, it says like body dot, I don't know, content dot main equals primary content, right, as an example. And what you would say is, okay, when rendering my products, I first want to override body content main and want to say, this is now rendered using my package, via the products, for instance, template, right? And then you would say, I want to change body sum CSS class equals bar or products. This is what you would usually do, right? You would say, okay, the page rendering, the normal page rendering is like this.
Mm-hmm.
And if you encounter some page of type products, then please render slash products. Mm-hmm. So we have to ensure products needs to be the same as page except some details, which is changing the CSS class name, overriding how, it's the same. Overriding how to change the content area. And so that overrides this thing here,
mm-hmm.
Right? And you tend to have this block. So in typical projects, we usually have, I don't know, 5 to 10 to 20 different document node types in bigger projects.
Yeah.
And that's why you have a lot of these kind of things.
So you add a lot of places to the
root. Yes. Exactly. And you have the problem is if at this point, because this is copied, let's say we want to we want to change the, let's say we say page.body.some, I don't know, let's say some other CSS initial. So let's say I want to at some point say I want to change body dot some other CSS class to new, right? So this modifies this here. Okay. The problem is this does not modify products because we didn't inherit from it, but we just copied from it. We copied it at the moment of in time here. Mm-hmm. And if we use real inheritance, it will just work way more predictably because the prototype the variable will still work.
You go down. Yeah. So for the products thing,
So for products, you would just say my package dot products dot document mm-hmm. inheriting from my standard page rendering, and then starting to override body dot primary. I don't know body dot content dot main equals my package products, for instance. Right. It's basically almost the same thing. It's just well more object oriented, so to speak, with less copying and more inheritance.
But I don't understand yet. It's for the Neos backend, for example, you would say this page has this kind of document type, and I would create a special node type configuration
exactly.
for this document,
which inherits some document. Yeah.
I would name it document. I would name it products.
Yes.
And I don't know what.
Well, and normally products are just rendered like pages, right?
So this, okay, wait, can you scroll back up? So this, down. So this also does not have anything to do with a node type thing?
Well, it only has because we take first the node type name.
Like a pointer down there.
Yeah, exactly. It's basically saying, okay, take the node type's name as it is, and then append document, and this is how you start rendering. That's the only thing, right?
You only need it so you don't use...
this big
so you,
case.
No, up no, 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 no. Okay. So you don't use... So that's your own?
Yeah, that's basically, it's all my own, right? All these two objects are my own, right? We have Neos page, that's the standard one.
And if you don't put the document... document, it would not be your own because you would be.
Yeah, I mean.
You would be like, why this dot document? I don't understand.
Because it says it up here.
And if I remove it, what happens?
Well, then we would use the normal. Then we would have a naming clash because.
That's what I mean. So that's only there for the. You would have
yeah.
a page there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
It's basically because you usually need to distinguish between like the overall layout of your website, which is the dot document stuff. It could be also called dot overall layout or dot something,
mm-hmm.
and the actual rendering of a certain object, which is usually named like the Neos node type, like the node type itself. Yeah, it's just a naming convention.
Yeah, it's a naming convention. With the dot document.
Yeah, just to see this is the entry point, and the cool thing about this is now. If at some later point in time I start modifying like this thing, like saying for instance body.some other CSS class equals new, then this also is applied to this one because this inherits from the other one. And that's real inheritance, that's no copying because it's a prototype, prototype on left, prototype on right. So you can start. I said it's just
yeah, okay, I understand. I just skipped one.
Yeah, it's just really like this is really like detailed stuff. It's just important that if you see this line, then you basically need to know, okay, it just reconfigures the system a little.
Nice.
And yeah, it is. And that's actually also the nice thing about Fusion. So the first versions we created and then we started playing around with them, and then we figured out what are the right conventions to work with and the right things to do. And it's all basically in Fusion itself, so you can just change Fusion a bit and change the conventions to try out something new and this kind of thing. So that's just the nice thing about it. Right. So I think that was quite a session, 1.5 hours, but I think hopefully good. Other questions, comments? Okay.
I have one more question related to code.
Yeah, okay, we can do that afterwards. Then.
Can you go into the root Fusion?
Which one?
this one.
Ah, yeah. And all the way down. So
yeah, that's still the old way, right? It's still
copies. Yeah, no, I saw something like cache, at cache.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, the cache was in the page, the default one.
Okay. Yeah. You can specify this in other...
everywhere. You can specify cache everywhere if you want. But that's just, like I said, Fusion is important because it also handles caching on a very fine-grained level if you want to. Mm-hmm. But that's, as I said, it's something like a new topic, I think. Like you can discuss that also, but it's usually not needed because the defaults are configured sensibly, so you don't need to change anything, basically. Mm-hmm. It's just in special cases where you need to do that. Micha, from your side, any questions?
No, not right now.
Okay, all right, then I think I'll just stop.